Vamos então continuar com o António, que vem de Barcelona, vai falar sobre o Gutenberg, primeiramente não pretende ter o alimento, vai fazer a sua apresentação em inglês, então vou passar a falar em inglês. António comes from Barcelona, and I was saying that I thought to him previously that whenever I talk with the people from Spain, I don't really know if I should say that they are Spanish or from Catalonia or from whatever.
Spanish, good.
Okay. But in talking about another topic that is not that controversial, let's talk about Gutenberg.
Yeah.
And you were talking about. We'll be showing us a set of good practices to follow when developing with Gutenberg, as well as some typical mistakes that one should avoid. So, is it mine? Okay.
Sorry.
It's okay. So let's hear it then. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So, this is probably the fourth Gutenberg talk today, so I try to be quick. Everything started with this slide from Matt Mullenberg, one of the co-founders of WordPress, back in 2015 in the WordCamp US. He assigned us to learn JavaScript deeply. So my question for you guys is, did you learn JavaScript deeply? One person? Two. Nah, to work with me. You don't count. So two guys, or at least one, learned JavaScript deeply. So I didn't. Okay? I didn't learn JavaScript deeply. Why? Because learning JavaScript was never a priority for my business. I, as a developer, earn money selling WordPress plugins. Plugins that are written in PHP, so JavaScript was never a priority for us. Until Gutenberg. I started learning JavaScript deeply back in December, 3 days before the final version of WordPress 5.0 was released. Because then, was where we realized when Gutenberg will be in the code. Just 3 days before it was there. And why 3 days before? Because our plugins were needed to be refactored or fixed in order to make them compatible with Gutenberg. So I had 3 days to learn JavaScript deeply. I didn't learn JavaScript in 3 days. So I started with the topic, and I thought that I only needed to learn JavaScript and Gutenberg. But then you discover, by reviewing the code base of Gutenberg, that there are a lot of technologies behind that. SNext, Babel, to work with modern JavaScript syntax, React for the components, Redux for the state of the application, SAS, because why not? Sling to detect errors, Webpack to bundle everything, and npm to work with dependencies. A lot of stuff, and that made me feel something like that, like a baby, because I didn't know anything about that. I was used to work with PHP, not with all this stuff that was only appearing in the front end. So, well, the first thing that we need is a modern build process. Now, you need to create something that, when you write JavaScript, produces a build file. It's like compiling. So, what I need is, like, we are in a... Because we are in an open source community, what I did was just to look at other guys that were doing the same. Other big plugins that were adapting themselves to work with Gutenberg. So I was spying them, I looked at their source code and extracted things from there and from others, and finally created a kind of boilerplate to create plugins that were adapted to Gutenberg. So I took information from them, and now I publish it on my GitHub for you to work. So it's easier now to work without taking into account a lot of configuration and dependencies and things that never mind. Okay? But if you don't trust my code, which is something that may happen, recently, in March, at the end of March, Gutenberg itself released the package WordPress scripts. This is the announcement. The links are on the bottom of the presentation for you to visit. And basically, you only need to import this package in your code, and you have a start and build to manage everything about the build process. So build process is covered. Next step, learning JavaScript deeply. I don't know if you bought these books, but please don't do it, because it's not necessary, especially this one. Unless you have a broken table, in that case you can buy it. Or maybe buy a new table. What you really need is only understand what's happening in Gutenberg. And to understand the WordPress, the Gutenberg code base, you need to understand modern JavaScript. This means SNext, X6, X7, all this stuff. So there's also here a link with a tutorial that explains all this stuff. This is an example of object destructuring, which is a very common statement in Gutenberg that I couldn't understand at first, because PHP doesn't have this kind of black magic. So imagine you have an object, post, with two attributes, title and content. This statement here is like defining content and title as variables from the object post. So you can use directly title and content instead of doing a post or title or post or content. So this appears in every file in Gutenberg. Learn that, plus the use of let and const from variables, classes, arrow functions, and all this stuff. This will take you at least 1 or 2 hours to learn, so it's pretty easy. You don't need that big book, okay? So now that you apparently have learned how to work with JavaScript, the next mountain to climb is React. React is very complicated, but the good thing about that is you don't need to learn React if you work with Gutenberg. You only need to understand the JSX syntax, which is like HTML with superpowers, something like that, that is placed inside your JavaScript. So if I want something like a heading like this one, I just need to put this in a return with parentheses like that. So it's pretty much HTML, but a little bit more complex. The good thing about that is that Gutenberg exposes a lot of components that I can reuse. For example, if I want to use a color picker, I only need to extract the color picker from the components package and use it like that. This wraps a lot of tips and stuff that I don't want to know about that. I only want to put it and I will get a color picker for free. So there are lots of components inside the components package that you can investigate in GitHub. There's a huge list. Here you have color picker, and when you go to inspect one of them, there is a description, a guide on how to use it, and everything. So you have this covered. But if you don't trust these components, React provides a lot of free components that you can use. There is a huge list in the React website, or you can find it in other places. So, reuse and don't reinvent the wheel, because probably someone created a React component before. And finally, the last final boss that we have here is Gutenberg. So we have learned how to develop things with a modern build process. We have learned the modern syntax of JavaScript. And we have learned the basics of React. In fact, the way to create components using JSX. How about Gutenberg? Well, Gutenberg provides you with lots of functions that you can use. Functions to create blocks, to clone blocks, to get the blocks that are in the editor, to get attributes of the post that is being edited, to reset the blocks, to eliminate everything, to replace a block, insert a block, remove a block. So you can do programmatically everything that you imagine. But today I only will deal with these three guys in detail. The first one is the most common one. It's register block type, which allows you to register a new block, of course. So it's pretty easy to understand. You only need to use the register block type function, pass as argument a name and an object containing settings. These settings can be a title, an icon, which is a dash icon, a category, and two important properties, edit and save. Edit, it returns a component, and here is where you put the JSX that we showed before. And save is where you put the final HTML that we will load in the front end. So pretty much that's how blocks are created. The good thing about that is that there are tutorials everywhere. Every person that wrote an article about Gutenberg explained this function. But there are a lot of more functions as we show here. Another function that maybe you didn't know before is a register plugin. When I say plugin, I don't mean a WordPress plugin. I mean a plugin that extends Gutenberg, that extends the editor, a plugin for the editor. The way to create a plugin to extend the editor is using register plugin with a name and an object with settings, an icon, also a dash icon, and a component, the component that will be rendered in the editor. So let's see how does it like the plugin component. It is a bunch of JSX wrapped in a fragment component. This is also from WordPress. And we have a sidebar menu and a sidebar. The sidebar menu includes a string with the name of the sidebar, and the sidebar itself contains everything that we want to use inside the sidebar. In this case, again, the color picker. So all these components are from WordPress. This produces this custom sidebar that you can see here, with the icon, which is the heart, the name, and the color picker. So if you want to create custom sidebars for your editor, that's the way to do it. And finally, this is a very interesting function, which is called subscribe, that lets you listen to changes in the editor. So anytime that a change occurs, the function that you put inside the subscribe function that WordPress provides you will be executed. This is an arrow function, okay, don't panic. It's like using function without the arrow, but instead of writing the function name, you put the parameters and the body of the function separated with an arrow. Let's see an example. Imagine that you want to execute the function onTitleChange that you defined in a file over there anytime that the title of your post changes. So you use the subscribe from WordPress and you pass a function that obtains the title of the post, these two instructions do that, and call your function. That's the way you can do it. But if you do it, like that, you have a problem. Because a performance issue. Because this will be executed anytime a change occurs in the editor. Anytime. If you click on a sidebar, this will be executed. If you change something, this will be executed. So that's not the way to do it. Instead, put an if on it. If the title has changed, then do the thing. If the title is the same as the title that I had before, just go. Okay. So if you use the subscribe method and you don't put a condition inside, you are doing it wrong. Okay? And beyond that, there are funny things that you can discover when writing with JavaScript. Like, for example, that imagine that you write a piece of code that uses the subscribe method, but the function that you pass as an argument has a mistake. Here, we define a variable, but we try to access the property B of this variable that doesn't exist. So your code has a mistake because you cannot read the property B of undefined, and this will throw an exception on your browser. Now imagine that I write this piece of code to subscribe to changes in the editor, just to put a message, a funny message in the console. The problem here is that any time a change occurs in your WordPress editor, the subscribe method will recover all the listener functions that it has and will execute any of them in order. So it will execute yours will throw an exception, and this will stop execution. So my code will never run. Okay? You can even try it in your laptop. Just open the JavaScript console, copy the two subscribe calls, and you'll see that if you just write something or click on something in the editor, your function will be executed, will throw an error, but the SOS will never go out. Okay? So be careful when writing JavaScript, because in this case the subscribe function is shared space. Okay? So my advice is that you are not alone. Please write JavaScript code respectfully, or you may break things. Okay? So back to the beginning. We were assigned to learn JavaScript deeply. But my personal recommendation today is that you don't learn JavaScript deeply. You must instead learn Gutenberg shallowly, because that will allow you to start developing things quickly and go deeper and deeper as you need. So that's pretty much what I have today. Thank you, Brigado.
Thank you. We have time for questions. Yeah. Let's go first.
I was curious about if you could elaborate on the use case that made you need to subscribe directly to the store, because there is a with select component that like auto updates, and if you are rendering UI things, you can also have side effects and things like that. So I was curious about what was the reason to use subscribe to the use case you chosen.
I don't remember right now, but it was something with the recovering the content, I think, because we have this plugin that takes the content of your post the post that you are editing right now, and create social messages automatically with the content. So every time to change the content, I want to change the result of my plugin. So that's why I need to do it after it changed. Because there is no function that lets me know when you have changed the content. Only the content.
With select, like there is an AR component with select.
Yeah, I know that, but with select does not execute every time that you change the content, or?
No, I think the thing is our plugin, it wasn't using a Gutenberg component yet. So it was legacy code.
Ah, okay. Yeah.
Okay. That's the thing. We couldn't use it with select.
Yeah, that explains it.
Note that was at the very first three days that I was learning everything, so I didn't even know that with select existed back then. So
yeah, because like if when you're working with React, with select is like
I know
the easiest way. Yeah, the way to go.
In fact, we are now refactoring one of these plugins from scratch using everything that we learned. Components and with select and with dispatch and with Redux and everything. So now makes sense, everything. But now, not 3 days before Gutenberg was released.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.